also struggling a little bit, but for Virtus Pro, they went up against Elements, and could they really show what they had in store in that series, you feel?
No.
No.
They didn't need to.
They didn't need to.
Yeah. It's the VP thing. Like, and VP was saying this at Boston as well. Like, we play what we play until something goes horribly wrong. We don't really change it. Unfortunately, what went for wrong for them at the Boston Major was in the best of three, and they lost.
Yeah.
And there was no coming back from that.
Now, then luckily for them, this is double elimination, but I would imagine that this time they might be a little bit better prepared. So, it is a game one. It's the best of three. It's the semifinals in the winner's bracket. We are in the draft, and Virtus Pro will have the dire side with OG on the Radiant side. Underlord, first ban. What are we expecting from the first couple of picks and bans?
So, look, against VP, it's much different than the other series that we've seen today. It's usually about Underlord, Juggernaut, SD, and Luna, I would say, are the main four. You generally want to break up the SD-Luna combination versus them, which is much easier if you're first pick.
And I also want to then see from VP what happens with OG's first support pickups, to see better rotation supports almost block picked in the first phase, or potentially just countered by your earlier heroes. So look for that Earth Spirit. It's a big one for both sides, so they both might let it slip through.
Maybe even the Pudge too. The creep pulling is very difficult to deal with. And I think VP are a very early game team, and they don't really want that to mess up their lanes.
Would you first phase the Pudge though? Like, I look towards the Pudge to be that second phase question mark.
Yeah, possibly.
And especially when you start banning out these type of heroes and you let both SD, Rubick, Luna, they've all come through the pool here.
And Drow Ranger, too. The Axe band is a little bit surprising because S4 plays a lot of different things. I think his Axe is good, but you know, certainly maybe not better than his Clockwork, his Batrider, a myriad of other heroes that he plays in the offlane. So this tells me that they probably want to do more, like either a weak melee safe lane, which doesn't really seem like VP style, or something heavily physical damage based, which is like a, you know, Drow Ranger strategy, which might be much more up their alley.
Well, there's all the heroes we expected to see. I was actually thinking if the ban was on the other way around, it would make more sense. It's like, okay, OG are going to ban the Axe so they can run their Dazzle without any kind of hindrance, but it's like the opposite way around with VP banning it.
Mm-hmm.
So we got one of the saving supports coming out from OG, and they pick up the Centaur with that as well. Now, the heroes you mentioned in terms of banworthy in the second phase, you said Pudge, you said Earth Spirit, Jarex heroes. Would you, like, you cannot ban out all the Jarex heroes, so which poison do you pick?
You still take out the Earth Spirit.
You still take out the Earth Spirit.
Unless you're picking it as the first one, then you still take out the Earth Spirit.
I personally don't think so. I mean, he can play the Shadow Demon in this situation, and they can just pair it up with the Dazzle. I think Dazzle works very well with their heroes and against Virtus Pros. So I don't really think you actually target Jarex with these bans in the second phase.
I just kind of prefer to see Jarex on a more initiating style control support. Like, I see SD come in, and SD into the later portion of the game. It's like, just make sure you get a copy of the Luna, and you've almost done your job if you've done that.
They already have S4 for that, though. He's on Centaur this game. Saw him on Brewmaster the other game too, so he can play that role where he just goes in first and starts off a fight.
It's interesting to see too, they pick up the Centaur this early on. Like after the Axe gets banned, I'm wondering if they're considering VP would focus more on S4 bans in the second phase.
Possibly. But I think Centaur is a good way to deal with the Luna. Like Luna doesn't really stand well one-on-one versus the Centaur, and Centaur with a hood is actually a very good counter to the early game prowess from the Eclipse. I've seen Centaurs kind of dominate a lot of Lunas in lanes, especially when they don't have a Shadow Demon to back them up.
Especially once you get the Aghanim Scepter over on Centaur too, that damage mitigation is so good to just like bail out from originally the initiation as well as take very minimal damage. She banned the Chen as well. Okay, OG must be slightly concerned about being overpushed, but VP, they're not phased. They don't delay. They pick the next Assassin straight up.
No hesitation at all. And Nine Pasha has already been hampered quite a bit. This next Assassin offlane for him? Is there a chance they run out of support?
I would assume offlane. Offlane would make the most meta sense with the draft, but they at least keep themselves open.
Yeah.
Picking it this early. It's strange that they pick Nyx right now, though.
Is it because you don't really feel like there's a straight counter hero?
Yeah, and I also think that Pasha, like if they were going to pick a hero for him just because they didn't exactly know what the opponents were doing, it's usually like Batrider, I would say, is a way more common of a pickup for them because he's more versatile, but Nyx Assassin, generally, you pick it versus Ember Spirit, versus Batrider, Storm Spirit, OD, yep. And none of those heroes are in the game right now.
although we have seen OG play a lot with Ember Spirit today, yeah, and against it even as well, maybe just wanted to prevent the Ember being picked up, or at least give OG a little bit of extra consideration before doing that.
Yeah, I think that's definitely true. I think it's also a good way to perhaps deal with all these heroes just kind of running on the Luna. I think that's generally the idea when you have a Centaur. Just stampede, run at her, tank her Eclipse, and just kill her early on in the fight, especially when they don't have any defensive supports yet.
Yeah. Even though Rubik is still, like, absolutely fantastic. I love him up against Centaur, because Centaur never gets in range when he triggers the Stampede aggressively. So Rubik just picks him up, steals the Stampede, and then triggers it.
Yep. But when you steal Double Edge, you're a sad, sad Rubik.
But then what's Centaur going to do? I'm running in with Stampede, I'm going to Double Edge a creep up my way through. Just before he hits his actual main target.
You got to be very well aware of the positioning of the Rubik in this case.
Yeah, I was actually really surprised that Rubik wasn't appearing more, both at ESL 1 Genting as well as just in the first couple of games today. Got ignored a hell of a lot. And, okay, hello, Lina.
That is unusual, to say the least. Now, old school, picked up together with a Shadow Demon, very common. We have also seen a phase in Dota where Lina was played mid. Where does this Lina fit in?
I think didn't they play it already as support? One team I'm pretty sure already plays Shadow Demon Lina, and it's rare because people like Lesh generally a lot more than Lina because pushes towers a lot better, and it's also versus a Nyx Assassin. I think Nyx Assassin does very well versus the Lina, but it is a good combination with the Shadow Demon, and I think it's also a good way to just kill the Luna outright in a lot of the fights.
Yeah, unless Luna's like really on the money with Manta style, then...
That's what you had the Sun for, bro.
Yeah.
Will the Luna be enough to force Lina to go... Will Lina be enough to force the Luna to go for an early BKB here?
That's the thing about the Luna, because if you have a Soulcatcher and then you Ags ult the Luna, it's like BKB doesn't matter. And Lunas actually don't build a lot of HP, nor do they build BKB recently. It's been like a lot of Lance Manta style.
Or a very late BKB.
Yeah, or very late BKB. Yeah. And I think Lina and Centaur and Shadow Demon, like, you really want to get BKB, but you also kind of don't want to get BKB because of the Shadow Demon ultimate. So it's going to be tough for the Luna this game.
I'm interested to see, actually, where the Lina and SD move early on, because if this actually is going to be a four-position Lina comboing out with the SD, maybe this is OG's answer to running that Rubik and Luna. Like, this hero combination, you get a couple of levels up, and then you've got like double stun, double control. Obviously, with the double magic coming through the back of those two as well. Like, Rubik and Luna can kill almost every offlaner, apart from the Centaur, unless it's like an ES rotator who's still in the pool. Then Centaur will have a very difficult time escaping.
Yeah, I think they could actually play very aggressively with the Shadow Demon Lina and pair against the Lina lane.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering if they're going to do. And now the IO pickup comes in. So a lot more sustain that arrives for Virtus Pro and adds a lot more question marks to me about their mid lane. Because this opens them up to actually go for a 2-2-1 with the Nyx on the off and then the IO supporting. And you can see some really classic combinations coming out with the IO.
And in terms of OG, does that mean that they kind of are forced to also go for a hero with a bit of extra sustain, like a Juggernaut in terms of their cores?
It depends on how they want to play it. If they want to pressure the Luna lane, they can go for like a very aggressive like Lifestealer Juggernaut. I think Slark also might be like okay. Terrorblade is a hero that they pick a lot.
Yeah.
They're probably one of the team that runs it the most, just for that extra tower push. They don't have any tower pushers aside from the Terrorblade. And it synergizes quite well with the Shadow Demon.
Mm-hmm. Kind of takes away though from that like initial aggro tri lane potential I thought they could be running.
Yeah.
Because when you pick up a Terrorblade, you're not going to say, hey, Terrorblade, go one-on-one with the Nyx Assassin.
I think you can.
You would?
Yeah. Sure. He has a ton of armor. It's not like Nyx Assassin is really going to burst you down. Much magic.
You're looking at more like an even trade then?
That's generally not how they play, though. Sometimes they will sack No-Tail, but generally they won't just pair them straight one-on-one situations, Terrorblade versus whatever.
I'm still waiting for VP to say, you know what, screw it. Like, we just pick up something more like the CK or the Tiny pickup and go for that dual mid, get early burst combination, something which both SD and Lina, even if they rotate around or if that SD is rotating to a mid Lina, they're going to have a hard time finding that early kill.
Depends on who the mid is. If it's a weak hero early, like Shadow Fiend, I think you definitely would, but the OG don't really pick those type of heroes very often for Ana.
Well, it's VP who gets to see the entire lineup from OG, so they're already a good advantage for that. And they banned the SF out as the last one, so they're still looking at VP's other mid.
And VP banned out the Dragonite themselves. Now, I know Ana plays a mean Dragonite, but does it give anything away about what Virtus Pro might want to pick in this situation?
I think they're just afraid of the push. Like, Wisp, yeah. I think, is particularly weak against, like, the early five-man. Same with Nyxassassin. These are heroes that you just want to five-man against a lot, and DK would just kind of naturally lead them to there. They could just easily push with meta plus DK form. So I don't really think it's more about the mid-matchup. It's just more about how they actually want to approach the game. So Ember Spirit already, like, kind of soft-countered by Nyxassassin, and another counter with the Invoker, and I'm pretty sure no one plays a very mean Quas Wex.
Oh, yeah, he does.
All right, so final thoughts on this draft, gentlemen.
I like VPs a lot more. I think OG kind of picked into their hands with the Ember Spirit and the Lina versus the Nyxassassin when the Nyxassassin was picked already before. And I think they have plenty of ways to deal with the anti-push with the Invoker, and they have ways to... I think it's just way more well-rounded.
Yeah, personally, I would have loved to reserve my comments until I see how the SD and Lina really play out.
Yeah.
But I don't think they've got enough to really bring down the Lunar and Rubick if the positioning and rotation from VP is good, which it almost always is. VP should be very, very stable in their lanes and take game one.
Any lane in particular that we are looking out for here?
I'd like to see how quickly Nyxassassin gets the early levels, and I want to see the off lane. How much work Centaur is able to do.
Okay, well, we're going to find out how much work that Centaur is indeed able to do as we head over to our commentators, Odipixel and Gods.
Thank you very much, Shiva. Indeed, it's myself and Gods getting ready to take you through the final series of today here at the Dota Pit LAN. We've got OG up against VP. We've just seen the drafts. We've seen the lineups. I mean, Gods, let's talk about this for a bit. What do you think about this? Just seeing Jerax on the Lina, something that you wouldn't have expected coming in today, a hero that's pretty much been overlooked.
It's a hero I've seen him play like every now and then. I think it's a hero he really likes to play, which is probably a part of the reason it goes into picking and putting players on comfort heroes, or heroes that they just have a good feeling about going into a game can make a big difference. And I mean, strategically, the big thing is that you can burst down the Lunar. The Soulcatcher, Laguna Blade, the burst damage potential between the SD and the Lina is pretty absurd, and Lina's a hero that benefits a lot from farm, because you think, like, oh, burst damage support, like, why don't you just pick, like, a Lion or something? You've got a few more disables in there, but Lina does a lot more with all the farm, and the Ags upgrade means Luna's BKB can be negated, so strategically a useful pick for them. Not perhaps quite as potent as some of his normal roamers. The Earth Spirit, the Pudge, these heroes can be a bit more disruptive in the laning stage, perhaps, but the synergy between the Shadow Demon makes up for it.
And another thing that's going to be very, very interesting is to see how it pans out this game. I feel it is going to become this whole Terrorblade versus the Lunar. I mean, who outpushes who? Who outfights who? You know, do the Glaives destroy the Illusions, or do the Illusions destroy the Lunar? I mean, what way does this kind of matchup go when we see these two turn up to the fights, do you feel?
Terrorblade has a bazillion armor, so Luna's right clicks take some time before Terrorblade starts worrying about them, but the Eclipse is the big thing. Come team fight. The Eclipse versus Sunder is one of those kind of interesting matchups as far as whether you can lock down the Terrorblade, prevent him getting the Sunder off, and whether or not Luna can like time the Eclipse with the disables coming out from the Nyx stuns or the Rubick lift so that they can burst down the Terrorblade. And then OG have some plays they can make, like they can try and save the Terrorblade if he gets low with the disruption if he's getting stunned to buy him time to get that Sunder off. We saw Notal have some good Sunders, some bad Sunders in his earlier Terrorblade game, and definitely a hero. He's very capable and also comfortable, and we've seen Notal play quite a lot of the Terrorblade.
Oh, absolutely, but it does look like we do have just a brief pause here, hopefully, and then we should be able to get game one underway between these two, you know, two teams. They've had a fairly long day, so coming to the end of it all, I've got to still pull out their best performances for sure against each other. These are two arguably the two teams that very well could expect to see at the finals here at Dotsbit.
And for VP, they have to want this so bad.
They've got to prove themselves.
Winning this tournament is like, that's your ticket to the next major. That means you're not playing in qualifiers. They're one of those borderline teams. A win here gets them into the top three and gets them that one step closer to taking this Dota Pit Championship. So definitely VP playing with a lot more to gain. OG on the other side, defending major champions, like very likely to be invited to the next major. Spoiler alert, guys. But VP have a bit more to prove and are definitely going to be more motivated to win this series.
Yeah, do you find it kind of interesting as well that OG are coming out with this Terrorblade pick so openly, you know, at this LAN? You know, they're turning up because this is a, I guess people knew that Notel was strong on it, But yeah, I mean, are we going to kind of see this from OG throughout the whole tournament? Or is it only against certain teams? Or do you think this is, they're kind of showing that this patch, this is one of their go-to heroes for Nota?
I think they're still in that pseudo-experimental phase, perhaps. It's a poor man's Luna, kind of. I think if they could play Luna perhaps over the Terra. I mean, in some ways, maybe they're happy with the Terra Blade because Notel's played it more.
I mean, I can imagine Notel probably has more fun playing Terra Blade than Luna.
Yeah.
Luna is...
They're very similar heroes.
That's the thing, they are.
TB does what Luna does in most ways a little bit worse. Like, he has a bit more downtime in terms of pushing because the Metamorphosis has a very long cooldown. But in similar ways, both heroes fight around a long cooldown. The Eclipse for the Luna, the Metamorphosis for the Terra Blade. Luna just, it feels like you have a lot more uptime, whereas Terra Blade is also a bit weaker in lane. So Terra Blade just, all around, just feels a little bit weaker than the Luna. But makes up for it in kind of other ways. The power of like Reflection is one of those really cool spells, which can be very good. You turn the Luna around on herself. Sunder, of course, can...
Actually, that's true, yeah. That's
fantastic.
We always kind of talk about, you know, obviously one of the ways of going up against the Luna, we see like Shadow Demon, Darkseer getting the illusions out. You know, Terra Blade, he's got that built in.
Yep.
Absolutely, something that could definitely have the potential to devastate Ramses if Fly's able to lay down a Demonic Purge onto him and get a few of those illusions out between himself and Notel.
One of the more like underrated spells of the Terra Blade.
Yeah, for sure.
It's definitely, there's been times where some Terra Blades will just like max it first. Like, I've seen mid Terra Blades go like max Reflection with Metamorphosis. They're not a build you normally see from a safe lane Terra Blade, nor do I think we'll see a build like that this game, but the spell is very strong. That's what I'm trying to get at there. But we'll see what VP have in store. I'm excited to see the IO come back out. That's a hero I feel is kind of being criminally underpicked on the new patch.
Yeah, one of Lil's strongest as well, kind of over previous patches at least, because as you said, ESL, a lot of us were kind of like, well, we're going to see IO. It's great. You know, you've got these extra bounty runes, you get the baller refilled, you're going to have much higher uptime, getting to the shrines, you're going to heal quicker. But yeah, it seems like teams just weren't favoring it. A VP switching it through. And I do like it because you look at the two lineups, Ramses, he is going to have the backup of kind of Lil on this support that's going to be able to save him. Over on the side of OG, you know, Fly, last time that they played the Terra Blade, they have Fly on the Dazzle. On the Shadow Demon, yeah, you're going to be able to have a quick save with the Disruption, but it's not going to nearly be anywhere on the same level as having a Dazzle backing up the Terra Blade.
Well, we'll get things back underway and see how things unravel here in the early game. Definitely Jarek's always the play to watch with OG early on. He is the playmaker, he's the roaming support, and he's the one who's going to be looking to get stuff done. And he will scout Solo out on his warding mission here. Solo with no items is, yeah, he's just going to lift and run. Lean up very swift.
I guess Solo as well, with that wraparound, seeing Jarek's coming back down from the north, will instantly assume Anady. The ping's already coming out from Pasha.
This is, this ward spot on this top banner is great because you see to the left side of the trees, the right side, as well as to the south river. It's a great ward spot, but it's also a ward spot that's very common, perhaps, or will become very common and get dewarded a lot.
Do you think it's likely we see either of the size contest a level 1 bounty rune?
OG more so. They're the ones with the SD Lina. For VP, they're probably looking to just secure their lanes a bit. They're sending lots of heroes to this top bounty rune. Pasha's playing very defensively in the trees. They're expecting more people to be around. Like, they're sending Lil out first because he can tether away. That's the idea here. But then they realize, oh, no one's here. We're safe. This is all good. We get a D ward. And we'll go on our ways.
Yeah, a little unfortunate there for OG. They did smoke up and try and go for some sort of movement. But Ramses was in a very good position, just kind of poised on top of the high ground and dispelled it. So OG unable to get themselves over. Both sides just picking up their respective runes. And it looks like, as well, scouting the lane down on the bottom, they are going to send Ramses back up to the top. They did initially have Pasha up there. So it looks like VP will end up getting the lanes that they wanted. Maybe were worried about OG going aggressive and wanted to take Ramses away, but they saw that OG weren't going aggressive. So they'll send him back up to the top. And he'll be up against this Centaur. So do you feel that this is VP getting the lane matchups that they wanted?
Yeah, they did not want to send their Luna against the SD Lina plus like Centaur tri-lane, like, or even SD Lina Terra Blade. They want to try to figure out where the supports are going to go, since Luna does have that attack range disadvantage against like a SD Lina support duo. So they get Luna in the farming lane. VP's a team who kind of hits their stride in the mid game, so they just want to make sure they have the safest possible laning set up so that they can get to that mid game where they make their aggressive maneuvers, they start taking towers, and they start really five-manning in a strong, powerful way.
And I guess the question is as well, on this bottom lane, you know, Toes was talking about how well the Nyx is going to be able to get the levels. Will Ninepash be able to get a lot out of this, or is he got to be very scared of this Shadow Demon Lehman?
He will if Lil can get this pull. He missed the first one. Lil at the Dire Tier 2 tower at bottom tried to tether the attack over to the creep wave and missed that one. He has the nice camp to do this, but without chopping down these trees, it's a little bit harder. He could actually just standard pull this if you chop down the trees using the tether, but instead he's trying to rely on hitting the tether timing as the Hill Troll or Dark Troll summon his attackers in the midair and drawing aggro that way. It's pretty tricky to do. We see Jarek's kind of circling that area, perhaps expecting Lil to be making this kind of a play or be in this position. Also circling the other Dire jungle, saying, hey, maybe he's stacking neutrals as well. But, yeah, Lil... missing that really hurts. If you hit that, get that pull, suddenly you're level 2.5, you get a bounty rune, you're almost level 3. That's what we saw earlier from like some of the pudges from Jarex and stuff.
Mid lane, Lil. So you're going to head over and just top no one back up. The CS at the moment in the mid lane, 6-2, 5-0, so even start between the two of them.
Another D ward, both Radiant Observer wards being taken out here. No one at least denied, but it is Vision taken away from the OG side. But the supports will go get Vision themselves. They're going to make the aggressive push towards the Dire Bounty Rune to snag that. And also just kind of keep tabs of where and what Lil is up to. They know Lil wants to be grabbed. Lil has had a terrible start to this game. He needs those Bounty Runes to try and catch up. And losing the Bounty Rune there, also being denied access back to his jungle where he could get the pull camp, means he's still a level 1 IO walking around.
Top lane making a bit of a go on to S4, bringing him down low. Ramzes and Solo, do they have the finishing touch? No, he couldn't quite get the vision there for the Lucent Beam. So S4 able to fog them and back off. He'll be
really
okay.
Good fog use.
He is still incredibly low. In fact, Lil, surely he can't do this on his own. No, that's why having a point in return.
This was trying to bait it, but...
No way at all.
I think he would have lost even in a right-click battle there with Centaur not using the Shrine, so... Centaur was trying himself back up and be ready to fight, and with Jarek sitting up in this top lane, this is dangerous.
Could set
VP
up something nicely. If they can get the Light Strike. He's just got the Hoost on because he didn't put a point in the double edge, so it doesn't look like they'll have enough damage. Lil comes across. Ramzes will be okay. Lil has to be a little careful himself here, as in fact another stun will connect. S4 and Jarek trying to corner Lil in the tree line. He will have another Tevra across, so he should be able to juke it. Heads back around, and now it's Jarek's caught out of position, and he's going to be the first to fall. VP claim themselves first blood. And Lil, he certainly had a tough time. That's going to help him out huge. Just getting that bit of a boost from picking up that first kill this game.
Yep. Jarek's a bit playing very aggressive there. It almost works out for OG. Got Luna very close to the threshold. Then Io got very close, but Jarek's in the end finds himself a bit out of position with how aggressive he played and gets punished. And yeah, that does help Lil a lot, who gets some much-needed experience onto his IO. Overall, lane's going all right for VP. The Luna kind of getting the farm you'd expect. No one in the mid lane. Doing good, but not great. Like, he's not kind of winning the counterpick matchup as hard as you'd like sometimes think, but Ember, of course, does decently well with the 4-man shield.
Oh, Anna and Jarek, they have found Lil here. They'll blow him up immediately with the combo. No one and Solo trying to go for a turnaround kill onto Jarek. Anna, can he save me? I actually got a DD rune here, so doing a fair bit of damage to Solo. They have lost Jarek. Can Anna find anything else in return? He turns back towards no one, but Lil backing up the Invoker as well. It could be Anna that's in trouble, as he's out of mana, trying to get himself back up to the high ground. Flies there, holds back one of the members of VP with a disruption. Jarek's going for the combo, brings Lil down with a stun, but it's not quite enough to finish him off. Anna walls up, can't get themselves back in, but OG do keep Anna alive. And we'll be able to get the D ward done in the mid lane as well. Ooh. Starting to get a bit scrappy here across the map. Both teams reacting to each other in full force. Radiance
both teams with their shrines will get back into fighting shape, which is really good news for the Ember Spirit, who's not quite level 6 but wants to get it. So he'll be able to head right back in that middle lane without having to make a fountain trip. And once he's level 6, then he can start playing around the Fire Remnants to have more efficient healing trips and bottle refills.
Oh, hang on, top lane, Ramzes managed to get a solo kill onto S4. That shouldn't happen, should it, guys? That must have been S4 making a bit of a miscalculation, a bit of a mistake, hanging around for too long.
S4's hoping no one's going to remember that one. But TP's right back up top trying to get some more experience. But
he's
got to
be careful.
Yeah, this could be a quick second death if he isn't careful.
Yeah, Ramzes now with the Eclipse available as well.
You've got that high ground ward right by his tower. I think S4 might just be dead here unless we see a clutch save from Fly.
He's going to be in a lot of trouble potentially if Solo wants to go for it, but they're not going to go full in. They do see, obviously, Fly in the neighborhood, so they know that there's backup and not wanting to blow everything on a failed attempt. So, like I say, Ramzes just continues to push the lane in. Fly still hanging around. They have lost that vision now across this area of the map, PP, so they have to be a little bit more careful. Mid lane CS still, no one having a great time. 34 for 11 against Anna's 22 for 1. Invoker taking the lead, but I guess that's kind of expected, is it, in this matchup for no one to have the easier time.
Yeah, a big part of the reason for the Invoker last pick is the matchup advantage over the Ember Spirit. I mean, looking at that last pick after the Ember, I was kind of looking at who are the counter picks. The Invoker, the Ursa were the kind of the two that stood out. Something we saw DC do during ESL, where they had Weeha playing those heroes and as a counter pick to the Ember Spirit, and no one doing very well here. The Tornado able to take off the Flame Guard immediately, takes away a lot of the Ember Spirit's early game potency. So VP will be pretty happy with how things have started off here, and once they get this IO a few more levels, then you can start seeing the Relocate come into play. We can see them start kind of five-manning to try to take some towers. Ideally want to look to use the Eclipse kind of to find a key kill if possible.
Definitely one of the highlights for OG's early game, though, is the fact that No-Tail has pretty much had an uninterrupted farm down here. I mean, absolutely Pasha. Still being able to find stuff in the lane, but hasn't really been able to slow down No-Tail's farm as well with the side pulls, keeping himself at the top of the CS. I mean, how much of an issue is it letting a TB have free farm at the start of the game? Is he pretty high up there on heroes that we should have dealt with earlier?
Not really. I think it's similar to the Anti-Mage, where you can give a hero like an Anti-Mage or a Terrorblade free farm if you've got a way to win the game when they hit, like, when they've got just one item. Like, an Anti-Mage with a Battle Fury isn't going to beat you. An Anti-Mage with Battle Fury Manta, that's the Anti-Mage you've got to be a bit scared of. So, it's a Terrorblade who, when he gets, like, that Dragonlance, starts pushing with his team. If you're stronger in a teamfight sense, like, you've got a Quazwex Invoker, Lunar Eclipse, you've got the Nyx and the Rubick for some teamfight as well, you're not going to be scared of a Terrorblade if you've got the teamfight advantage.
This is OG kind of making one of those classic OG moves here. You know, getting No-Tail involved in the action early on, 7 minutes in, looking towards the top.
I wonder if Pasha's called this, because it is some time that No-Tail hasn't shown in this bottom lane now. They've got to start thinking something's up.
They're going to stampede. They really want to try and get the lead in. There's the setup. S4 moving into position. Mass TP is coming through. They'll look to blow at Ramzes immediately, and they will. They'll take one kill. Can they get anything more? That's the question. No one. TP's across, has the EMP, but again, S4 with another Hoostom and a double edge. The illusions, of course, doing work as well. They'll pick up a second OG, and they're not done yet. Anna, Remnants in, looking for Solo, trying for the TP out, but the Light Strike array is there from Jerax, and OG claiming three heroes with that movement, and they should get a tower as well, God.
Such a good move. And the beauty of that is there's nothing you're really scared of that can punish you. You've got the Stampede, so you're guaranteed to get on top of the Luna, which means you can burst her down before the Eclipse is anything. And VP, their counterplay is to TP in, and by the time you've TP'd in, that Luna's already in a position where she's going to die, can't get off the Eclipse. The fight's lost without an Eclipse there, and that's where VP's best bet is. I mean, in hindsight, very easy to say, they should just let Luna die, head it off elsewhere. And I mean, hindsight's also 2020. Perhaps they should have maybe realized what was going on with TB's absence from the bottom lane, but OG just very fast to make that move up top.
Pasha was doing his best to find as many levels as he could down bottom, and he's nearly getting on to 7. So he's got the 6, he's vendettering up, he's immediately going to see if he can find a bit of action as he heads towards the mid lane. Because he's set up with a Spike Carapace, immediately going for the server, can't quite get it there. The chains held him back, but it doesn't look like it matters because Solo's there with the telekinesis. They surround Anna, surely he can't get out of this one, he can't. Pasha, with a final swipe to the back with the claws of the Nyx Assassin, will end up getting the kill. If they are able to punish Anna. What one of the nice things, I guess, really about that Nyx, that the whole Spike Carapace and Flame Guard interaction, you got to be careful if you're that Ember.
It was nice. Until he did get the power off.
I mean, yeah, he didn't get the stun, but could the chains.
The level 2 Carapace is not quite enough to get the Vendetta hit off, it seems.
Now, immediately, VP moving over for more blood as Jarax, caught a little bit too deep in enemy lines, is taken down. Two kills in quick succession. It looks like VP aren't done yet. Immediate smoke up.
They smoked a Luna who popped out, though, so if OG were watching, they may have realized and seen it, but it looks like No-Tail's still around his tower farming. Now will tuck himself in the trees, but this could be a death coming his way if he's not careful. Luna does have a clip still.
TPs are coming through. Solo is incredibly deep here. I think, yeah, they did catch a whiff of him moving past. And, yeah, Flight is hunting him out. Solo has been surrounded. He's very deep. He's close to the tier two. And No-Tail flying Jarax. He should be able to take the kill. I say that. Solo, he's making them work for it. Not hard enough, though. Jarax picks up the kill and brings himself even closer to the six. Mid lane again. Pasha catching out Ana. Ana, is he going to have a chance to get out? Plus the charges of Stampede as well. It's not enough to save him. That's what trying to save him from across the map. But these ganks on mid, they're paying off for VP, crushing Radiant's Ana twice in quick succession, pretty much within a minute.
Yeah, that's very important to find those couple of kills there. Really sets Ember behind. His net worth takes a decent hit. He's behind both his two cores on his team, and the Invoker Luna, the two kind of big breadwinners as far as this early game goes. And this Invoker will go back for that Midas after the phase boots.
Fly. Was looking for the setup, but again, Lil. Just there in time to boost no one to the side. And the Quaz Rex build is getting quite elusive, this Invoker. Speedy.
I like this though. OG are making another move. As soon as the Metamorph is back up, they're like, all right, let's group up a little bit this five. Let's make a play, make some SD illusions. And, well, you may not be seeing SD Luna, but you're seeing some SD Terrible now.
It's similar stuff here. As you mentioned, just the pushing power, the pressure that they can put on. VP are trying to amount the defense. They brought in the full lineup. And look at this Solo, the mini Terra Blade. That's incredibly cute there. Oh. Look at him go.
He just wants to fit in with the cool kids.
He's packing a fair punch as well with it. Not a bad spell to steal. And VP do hold them off. They take a hell of a lot of damage to the tower. They do keep it up. I'm sure OG will want to stick around and try and finish it. But OG putting a lot of attention on this push.
He's going to use the rest of it to farm the Ancients, it looks like. And this tower may just get denied if Solo wants to, but it looks like he's going to keep the creeps off it for now. Losing that mid tower doesn't matter as much as it used to now that there's that shrine around the mid lane, so you can TP there. And it's a lot harder to invade the dire jungle. You do lose the vision aspect of it, but you've still got that TP location. Yeah, so I think OG are going to be looking to create a bit more space for Ana at this point. He's kind of set back, getting a slower Veil than he would have hoped for, and I think at this point, until he has the Veil, OG don't want to force the issue too much. They want to take this tower if possible, or at least get... They don't mind if it gets denied, they just want to make sure it actually goes down, since they've invested as much as they have.
And they want to try and get something done with this pickup. You know, S4 has the blink complete.
Oh, Jarax, is he going to get it?
Hey, nice bit of money there for Jarax.
That Radiant High Ground Ward, letting him know the timing for it. And here comes Nyx once
still
again.
Still sticking around mid both sides. Pasha going for the setup. Will there be any sort of save here? OG trying to come forward. S4 jumps into the back lines, but immediately the MP comes through. He's out of mana. We'll get the double edge off in time to bring down Lil, but they've lost Ana for this. They're going to probably lose S4 as well. He tries to play his way out with the stampede. It's not going to be enough. He's down. Jarax takes a fade ball to the back. That's three dead on OG, and Fly's in trouble as well as VP closing on the Shadow Demon. Pick him up. And it's a 4-for-2 trade. They did end up managing to kill up the Nyx Assassin there with Fly's Demonic Purge. But VP finding the trades. They may have just lost the Tier 1 mid, but they'll quickly move in to attempt to take the Tier 1 back in return.
Dang, this Ember has been the undoing of OG this game as far as how the pickers match up against Nyx Assassin. And time and time again, Ana just finding himself in a really tough position. And his team go in to try and help him out. They're like, that's how Ember Spirit. That's a hero we've got to at least try and save, but just leads to further losses, and OG's early game has really suffered as a result. Just about to finish off that Veil at least, but it's now three deaths to Ana's name.
Do you like this build from Ramses as well, this game? Going for that Mask of Madness, Luna, rather than the helm, as we'd probably expect to see.
It's interesting. This is like the power farming build. I've seen like some of the more greedy players go for this Mask of Madness. This is a build that Black loves to do on his carries, going for this Mask of Madness for the super farming that you get from it. And it's a I mean, it's a build where you're getting a lot of your attack speed and damage through the Mask of Madness active, which is something like that's not going to get reflected onto you from a Terrorblade.
Oh, sidelines here. Fly trying to lead in, but it's actually VP getting the grab on him first. That's going to be one down, Pasha. Ready to go for more. There'll be a buyback from Fly. The combo there! S4 with a follow-up from Anna. Immediately blowing up three members of VP, and they may not be done yet. Pasha will find Jerax. But S4 moving up, he's going to have the Hoofstomp just in time. The chains is there as well, and OG pick up a fourth. That combo really bringing OG back into the game. They were starting to suffer off the back of the last few team fights, but S4 setting up the plays there.
Yeah, that was a three-man stomp into double edge. He did 2.4k damage. That's the center doing that damage. It's not like he just set up the fight and then Ember cleaned up. He did the damage as well. That stomp into double edge was brutal. I think it was a Veil double edge as well, so it got amped up by the thanks to the Ember Spirit. Yikes. That was just VP not cluttering when they did not want to be cluttering.
I guess they just didn't expect that amount of burst, as you said, with the Veil. Just ridiculous amounts of damage coming out from that combo. And it's putting S4 nice and close to his hood.
SD did buy back, not really too big a problem. 400 gold loss. It wasn't a needed buyback in the end. Fly didn't really offer much on his respawn, but it was more like a, hey, we want to fight. Let's make sure we have my save. So if he doesn't hit that three-man stomp and only stomped one, you may have seen a more even fight where it was needed for the SD to buy back. So not the end of the world there. And VP gonna, I think, look to settle down, reset a bit, maybe finish another item or two. I mean, you're playing around a Midas Invoker. You're not exactly in fighting shape as far as no one's con- He's got the levels, but he hasn't got the items yet. His Yule Scepter coming up in about 600 gold.
Ramsey's back up onto the top.
Be careful with this Mask of Madness. This does make him fairly squishy to the Lina Centaur duo.
Yeah, for sure. We have to kind of really see Jerax find an opportunity to go for a pick with this Laguna Blade. Bottom lane though, Pasha. I mean, this has really been the man that kind of cemented this early game momentum for VP. He's going to be spotted out. No kind of follow-up, just Fly, just giving him letting him know that they can see him. Sending him packing in the jungle though. Anna with the invis and an arcane rune bottled as well.
Huh.
Good look to start something if he finds a lock, if he finds Lil as such.
He needs Central. Maybe needs a,
yeah, I mean, S4's clear. He's got Stampede and Blink. He can close the gap.
Yeah, with a Centaur, Blink, Stampede on over, could be a likely kill on the Luna. Imagine the call maybe wait till Luna pops like a Mask of Madness and then go aggressive. And then you've got that amp damage. Well, at least from the minus armor. But it is largely magic damage, though, so...
I don't know if they may have seen him come across there with the Invis, because they've got a couple of sentries mid still, VP. So, and with the movement as well for them, looks like they may be aware what's going on in the jungle. So could be unlikely that they find the connection there, OG. The
nice thing about this new Mask of Madness is it reduces your armor rather than amplifying damage, which in this game, at least early mid game, is very magic damage heavy. The Ember, the Centaur, those are the heroes they're getting on top of the Luna. The Terrorblade is a problem later on, but that's when the Mask of Madness can either be replaced or just used in more conservative ways. So it does make a nice kind of early game pickup to fight with.
Indeed. They read the situation there. Lil and Ramsey's the back off. Just move over to the other half of the jungle to continue farming. And Anna and Jerax just reveal themselves to put some pressure onto this top tier 2. At the same time, VP will finish off the tier 1 bottom. And Yule Scepter now picked up on no one, so that extra bit of catch, extra setup, and something else that Anna's got to be very careful about moving in towards, as they have a lot of tools to deal with that Ember Spirit.
Free tier 2 top though, with OG already set up, they've surrounded this tower, they've got numbers, you can't really get up there in time to do anything about this. So there's not even a clear trade for VP. I mean, they took the tier 1, I guess, already. They're not taking the tier 1 mid though. And Terrorblade will get the tower. It'll probably farm up the jungle during a bit of this metamorph duration. And nice little bit of cash going TB's way, considering he is being outfarmed by the Luna at this point.
Pasha, eyes onto Anna. They're going to go for the combo. Io is going to be bringing him back up. Can they take him down in time? Ramses is brought across. There is the backup from S4. Jumps in with a stomp. Allows time for Anna to remnant away. Stampedes as well. Can they actually get a kill out of this OG? They brought No Tail across. Again, another great stun, allowing Anna to remnant forward. They'll burst down 9 Pasha. They found one. And now VP will get out. Solo did manage to steal the Stampede, so they'll save everyone else. But a very, very nice reaction there. S4 with some big stomps, protecting Anna and allowing the team to turn it around and get kills themselves.
Yeah, we're seeing Anna just tanky enough now with the Veil and just being a bit higher level, a bit more stats, the magic wand. They just can't quite burst him down. When you had the flame guard up, you get to get that initial stun and you get to try and chain stun burst him down. But with all the HP he's got, he survives through it, still had enough mana that he could fire Remnant away after a slide of fist. And that kind of baited VP into a bit of a tough position there where the Centaur counterplays were a bit too much to deal with. With that, I mean, you kind of can see OG's game plan here. They're able to just take towers as five whenever they've got Metamorph up, and when they don't, they're just playing a bit more defensive reactionary. And once they've taken all these out towers, then we'll see them probably eye off Roshan, take out the shrines. Very systematic stuff, even though they are being slightly outfarmed by the Invoker Luna. They're playing much more as a team.
I guess they kind of outfarm. Is that sort of expected, would you say? Invoke having his Midas and Ramsey's going for that Mask of Madness build. VP yep. should be ahead for the most part when the game's going even in terms of kills and fights.
Oh, yeah, and OG's prioritizing a lot more grouping up as five to take towers rather than like the farming efficiency, using their jungle to its full potential. Imagine if you look at Luna's total neutrals farm versus the Terrorblade, Luna's probably got like 3-4 times more neutrals killed and has just been a lot more greedy, I guess, as far as the playstyle goes. And I think that's what VP are looking for. They want to approach this more towards the later stages. They know that OG are going to be the ones who want to try and push a bit more now. And VP happy to kind of sit back, settle down, wait till they hit a few of these few more items. And I mean, really, Invoker's one of the most, if not the most, level dependent here in the game. So they want to really get no one in a position to shine before they play too aggressive.
Certainly doing well at the moment in terms of his pace, no one. Only that one death as well. Well, we're back in. Looks like we have to continue solo. He's heading towards the mid. Actually making a bit of a beeline on his own. Has to be a little careful, OG. Not fully around in the neighborhood. Pash is going to head across as well. Maybe seeing if they can form some sort of attack onto OG. Lil ready to bring Ramses in at a moment's call. His relocate is back.
Next Metamorph coming up. And that's OG wanting to, yeah, they're going to siege. Force a reaction, and they're very good at playing around their defensive spells, which is where it's hard for VP to initiate because of the Centaur counter initiation, the disruption save. Jarex is sitting back ready to burst down anyone who gets too aggressive, and TP's so far back because of this Dragonlance range that this is just a free tower.
Oh, they have found the chains, allowing S4 to jump in and combo down the Rubik. Solo's out for 30 seconds, and no tail. Still with a good amount of duration on the Metamorphosis. They could even pressure for more hit gods, couldn't they?
Yeah. It's
any reason to stop?
It's going to be slow because TP would be on the low ground. You don't want to go high ground with the TP. You've got to hit from the low ground, so you've got the uphill miss. You've got to have vision, so it's probably you could get that tower down to maybe half HP at best, but it's also very risky, so they back off. Metamorph wearing off soon. Not really worth the potential losses, and they'll just, again, it's wait for their Metamorph cooldown. That's the big spell they play around. And the real difference here, I mean, between the two teams that we're seeing, I mean, I kind of compared TB to the Luna and looked at TB like in some ways as a slightly weaker version of a Luna. One thing TB does is when you pop that long cooldown Metamorph, you guarantee you push a tower. Luna, your ulti's more for a team fight, and we're not seeing any value out of this Eclipse. We haven't seen an Eclipse really, one Eclipse the whole game, I want to say, maybe? VP have not been making the aggressive maneuvers. They haven't been getting value out of this spell, whereas Metamorph has been used 5, 6, 7 times, and every single time it's being used, towers are falling.
Mid lane pressure's being put on here by VP. OG kind of teasing with the idea to fight, but they back up. They'll let VP take that one. VP claim the tower. More money into Ramsey's pocket, putting him saves very, very comfortably at the top of the net worth. 11,500 net worth at this point.
It feels like what VP needed to do earlier in this game is every time OG five-man push, use Metamorph, get a tower, go and take a tower back. There's no Metamorph up. You don't really want to fight and defend towers like that in OG's position without the Metamorph. It's very risky. And if VP position right, where it's just the Luna in the front, you don't really want to engage on a one hero with the Centaur. You can take that tower pretty safely. So they need to just be in a better position to punish that Metamorph going on cooldown. It looks like they get the T1 mid, they're immediately top. Trying to still make another go. Manowolf is back up this time, but I think VP just feel like they can get up here faster and make something happen before OG can fully react.
What do you think about this decision from Mano as well in terms of his build? He's actually picked up a Blink Dagger relatively early on, so the Veil bots into the Blink.
It's a gap closer. It synergizes well with the Centaur, who initiates in on the Luna. Then Ember can immediately be on top of the Luna as well, and it also gives you that safety that you still got the Fire Remnant to escape. You don't want to aggressively Fire Remnant in, because then you've got no escape plan. So you can just Blink in, Searing Chains, put your Flame Guard up, do some good damage as well, and then save your Fire Remnants for escape purposes.
All tier 2s taken off the board by OG. So they are ready to put pressure onto any of the lanes, and they still have that kind of little pots of gold around the map that they could still take from the shrines.
A tornado missing due to the disruption means some damage could be done here, but Logan comes in, Deathwing Blast to disarm, and yeah, this will be the end of the push.
Ooh, nearly catching Jarex with that stun. Crash is immediately going to chase down, see if we can find anyone else, but already the TP is out from Flight. And the rest of them, they're back to safety. So VP unable to get any sort of punish, but they're holding onto their high ground. It's yet to be the opportune moment for OG to push on for more. And as we're mentioning, farm is looking very strong for VP's cause. Ramsey's continuing to sail ahead. The gap is certainly getting bigger between him and Nota.
This feels like their timing. You've got the Blink initiation on Pasha. They just used Metamorphosis to do some damage. Go and get something big if you're VP.
Oh, it's a good setup. There's the follow-up. It's not there because S4 coming in with a counterplay immediately onto Ramsey's Lil. Tethers across. Is he going to take him out? Has he got any sort of save here? That's the question. No. Relocate. Yes, there we have it. Just in time. Will remove the Luna from the fight, but Pasha's left behind. Solo as well in a lot of trouble as Hannah and the team chase him down. Pick up a second. And of course, Lil, he will be on his way back and they'll pay with a third death as well. VP getting absolutely crushed down there on that push. As you said, it on paper it looked like an opening to go. Metamorphosis wasn't there, but again, S4 just catching out the heroes on the back lines like he does makes it so hard for VP to get a push together.
Yeah, this Centaur Ember duo just with a ridiculous amount of burst damage, and I don't know if that was the best target to go in to support Lina. Invoker also, I mean, going for the Sunstrike missing a bit unfortunate, but that's not really anything to do with how that fight went poorly for VP. No one needed to be there with the Tornado, the EMPs, and offer a bit more in terms of overall utility rather than just a attempted Sunstrike. And it didn't seem like VP were all quite on the same page with that move. And as a result, it's VP finding themselves on the losing end and potentially losing a Roche because of this.
Overall, VP are still in the lead with overall net worth because of the farm that they're getting. This Roshan would certainly offset it if OG get away with it. The Dire have scanned it out, so VP know that OG's in the area. Pasha to lead the right way, and their team should be able to arrive in time to contest this here. OG do have to be a little bit careful. Yeah, VP could get a really good jump.
They're going to leave No-Tail in the pit probably, but no one comes in with a nice combo.
Immediately comboing No-Tail down low, will be kept alive by the pipe. He gets a good Sunder off onto Pasha. S4's there with the play to bring down the Nyx Assassin. Ramses in the middle of it all with the newly found BKB with the Eclipse, bringing No-Tail down low. He's not got the Sunder, of course, to save him. There'll be a defensive disruption from Fly. Ramses has got to back off as he's been Demonic Purge. Immediate change onto the Rubik. The S4 again getting into position, taking down a fourth as VP fall. OG secure their position around the Roshan pit, and they should be able to get away with finishing it. No one's still alive, but it's questionable how much he can do on his own to disrupt this. He'll send in a tornado, but he's already heading away.
No-Tail's pretty low. Oh, God, that's close. No-Tail got past the bottle. That bottle from Anna that he got saved his life there. He got
over the tornado.
Two charges. Yeah, he got two charges out of it. Grab. Yeah, he got. Yeah, he just.
Well, a very painful fight there for VP, really. Now, Ramsey's, you know, as I said, turning up with the first use of the BKB. And he just couldn't quite kill No-Tail, bringing him very low, but the pipe, the Sunder, it all worked out. And again, S4, he has been having a great day today, and this game is certainly not an exception. 7-2-10, and each and every team fight, the Houston's making the difference.
Yeah, for all the farm on this Luna, she just hasn't felt like a huge threat in these fights. Her ability to do damage has been kind of taken away by S4's great initiations and the burst damage coming out from like the Lina, the Soulcatcher as well. There's an Aether Lens now to go with the Yules on Jarex. And this is such an aggressive potential that threatens this Luna every time she gets near a fight, coming not just from like a centaur, but from a Lina and an Ember Spirit. All this magic damage makes it very hard for Ramses to fight. And he doesn't have that. And the Nyx is kind of trying to be that frontliner, but we're seeing Pasha often just get blown up at the start of the fight. So here that kind of wants to vendetta in, but also may just have to blink in, so it's a very tough game for Pasha to play this Nyx hero.
Runners found Lil on the back line, so Stampede to set up, needs to burst him down. Well, with S4, they'll make short work of the Iot. Again, OG finding the pickoffs, opening up the map and setting up to take him down a shrine. More gold into the pocket of OG. SVP won't be able to do anything in response to keeping that shrine alive. Still Ramses. I mean, it really does feel like he's obviously got the butterfly queued up. He needs that butterfly, because even with the BKB keeping himself alive, the damage still isn't quite there for him to really have an effect against No-Tails terribly.
Yeah. No-Tails is going from objective to objective, and this is even kind of like before that super scary TP stage. The Manta's now there with the Dragonlance. It's like the first pusher fight with it, but it's really just been the straight up Metamorph. Just go down the lane, push, and do what you can, and kind of see No-Tail, even from his talents, he's gone for the plus health over plus damage. It's damage just for your hero, since your illusions aren't getting that damage, I believe. Actually, I don't know how the talents worked with your illusions. I assume they don't. But.
No, I assume it wouldn't, wouldn't it? It's just what, flat health. I imagine it was like bit boosters and such. Mid lane, No-Tail, ready to go. Puts the metamorphosis and incoming with the push. Can VP hold them back? I've got pretty good high ground defense with Norn's Invoker and such. And already looking for some sort of a setup here. EMP is laid down, forcing OG to back off. S4 did actually pop the hoost. Looked like he was trying to go for some sort of a blink, but his blink was cancelled. Holds him back. Probably for the best. You've got to be careful jumping into the high ground here. No-Tail already falling incredibly low and out of mana. This Invoker hold certainly proving to be an issue for OG as they try and make it up to the high ground.
Yeah, they're holding, but they're not really threatening to go in and get aggressive. They're just delaying the push, which is good. That's what they need to do. They don't want to leave their base, but they're just kind of minimizing the damage OG is doing to this tier 3 tower, actually keeping it above half HP as Metamorphosis wears off. So very good effort from VP. They'll be... perhaps, yeah, no more Metamorph. This age is going to expire around the time Metamorph comes back up, so that's pretty much the one big push attempt OG had with the Aegis and Metamorph, so VP,
they hold serve. Might get himself a bit of a freebie here. He's actually going to whiff the stun. Jerax immediately just holds back the Nyx Assassin with the Yule, Stampede from S4, and Jerax out to safety there. That missed stun kind of costing VP a free potential kill.
That's a bit annoying. Looking at the kind of net worth, you kind of see the problem VP are going to face. They've got two very farm cores, but OG have four heroes getting decent farm. So yeah, Terrorblade, Ember, they're not as farmed as this Luna, but you've got farm on the Centaur, on the Lina. There's a Lina who's queued up a Rod of Atos, could go into an Ag Scepter if she wants to for the Luna BKB. The Centaur is going to have an Ag Scepter. That's a really teamfight changing spell. You pop Eclipse and suddenly Centaur uses an Ag Stampede and no one's taking damage. It's really going to become a story of four heroes playing like cores on OG's side against two on VP's. So I do worry for VP's ability to transition to the late game. There's a tremendous amount of pressure, probably more so on the Invoker than anyone, to be that super scary late game Invoker.
Solo. He's getting caught out, but steals the Remnant, able to get away, and now VP comes straight into the fight, put the BKB, the Eclipse. Anna, Remnant's up to the high ground. In fact, he's just going to TP out of there, and it looks like he will get himself safely away. S4's already being picked off, though. They'll surround Fly. VP will take a second here, and Jax reveals himself with the Laguna Blade. He's now kind of surrounded in the tree line. The Illusions actually forcing him back as well. No-Tail tried to turn up to back up the team. Anna's back in. In fact, a jump forward from Pasha. The Spike Carapace, but he's not going to be able to catch them out. And in fact, Jerax just turns around, takes him out of the Dragon Slave. Now Ramses and Orn are able to beat down on the Lina, take Jerax's life. So overall, VP getting the fight that they want, really, is a good bit of a gold swing. Anna will get himself out of safety and No-Tail surviving. So kind of the two big cores living. But a good fight for VP there. Good reactions, and maybe just OG getting a little too kind of hungry for blood as Anna jumped forward there. So kind of close to the realm of the tier 3.
They felt like they had a good position to go for that maneuver, I imagine, with the high ground ward. They had a lot of good vision, but Luna's rotation in as the stuns came out on the Ember proved to be very problematic. Even though Ember survives, the whole OG team is forced to commit to, like, basically stick around the Ember. Like, okay, our Ember's been gone on. That's an eclipse, but we need to stand with this Ember. This is our core hero. And then suddenly it's a fight being turned around. Once the Centaur goes, the Centaur is very important for this OG team fight. In terms of damage control, that 13-second cooldown on the Hoof Stomp has been a key disable for them. So S4 dying early on in a fight is a good way for VP to try and approach things.
And Ramses is just getting absolutely massive at this stage. And thanks to flies like that.
Goes for Lincoln, not the butterfly. So wants to stop the disruption coming out on him, at least partly. The Sunder, of course, very good at stopping TB, just randomly sundering you in a fight when you're not expecting it. The Laguna Blade. It's pretty nice because there's not many easy spells you can just throw to cancel. I guess the Demonic Purge is perhaps one, but that's not...
How do you kind of free up your slots? You've got a lot of effectively defensive kind of secure items, and damage isn't really going to be there at the moment for Ramses.
It can look to use the ultimate, I guess, for damage. He'll probably replace the Mask of Madness with the Butterfly next, and he's so far ahead in farm that, like, he dishes out damage just through levels and having just what he does. Like, the Lincolns is still at least some stats and some, like, a tiny little fraction of damage. Or OG of the high ground here. No one.
S4 with the lead in, the perfect stun locks down, immediately just getting blown up by Laguna Blade, and they're not done yet. They're going to look for another core, but Ramses pops the BKB, ready to turn. No Tail with his BKB as well, manning up against the Luna, but in fact, the damage is too much. No Tail falling low, and he's out. No Tail's down. There'll be a buyback from No on VP. They want to find more. Solo remnanting forward, another remnant to close the gap. On to Fly, telekinesing him back into the Sunstrike. VP, take a third. Big fight again for Virtus Pro. OG starting to slip, it feels.
Yeah, Notel was like running around. He had the Sunder. He didn't want to use on the Luna, who was about the same percent of HP as him. He saw a chance to go for the Rubick, but didn't get it off. If he got that Sunder on the Rubick, could have been a different fight for him, but...
And I mean, just look at the damage Luna did. I mean, with the Eclipse, and at the right click, so, I mean, as we said, he doesn't really have a damage item as such, but, I mean, it's a Luna god. He's just going to punch like a ton of bricks.
And you can't easily go in that Luna with the BKB and Lincolns. The two defensive items guarantees that Luna can just stand there, just glaives away. And by going defensive items, it means she's really dishing out more damage in a teamfight as a result. And OG got a bit overzealous there. Like, the pickoff on Invoker was big for them, and they just needed to kind of reset, settle down, and kind of make sure they play around a better position. Wait for the catch themselves. They just kind of ran at the Luna with a Searing Change. They didn't have any clear follow-up to it, and it was a very easy turnaround for VP. But Roche has come back up, and that's something where OG will look to perhaps go back to that more calculated strategic approach, take an Aegis, and then look to slow siege the high ground using that Metamorph. That mid-tier 3 tower is still around that half HP mark, something they'd like to kind of snag when possible. And with an Octarine on Ember, they have very high uptime on Ana's hero.
Let's see if they can get the catch. Jarax leading the way, has that Yule Scepter set up.
Oh, this could be a dieback for no one.
If they can catch that invoke, it'll be huge. S4 again with a big Who's Stomp. There's immediate pressure with the return, but they jump forward. No one BKP'd. Yule's up as well, trying to get himself out, but he's down. They've lost two. That indeed is invoke out for a good 100 seconds or so. Slide of Fist for Mana to cut down a third. OG knocked out three of VP. None of them with buybacks available. And Metamorphosis has just come back off cooldown, so OG ready to push up to the high ground. This is pretty painful for VP. They have a fortification, but no invoker for 70 seconds. I don't know how they're going to hold Gods.
I don't think they hold the mid lane. The question is, how do you hold your tier 4s or your other lanes? Because OG aren't going to stop here. They're going to go for a second lane of racks. They head bottom where the tower is already low. It's looking like a second lane. I don't think they can stop the second lane. Luna's already like pissed off to the bottom lane. Like, I'm out of here, guys. I'll defend later on. At least wait till it's like a 4v5 without the invoker. And there we go. Luna's back. They're going to defend this third lane of racks. And so we'll get a second to think about how they do that.
Yeah, they're still, as you said, without that invoker, it's so hard for VP to hold on. And we can see what kind of the network. It's been a very up and down close game, but just one lost fight and just the pushing power of Terrorblade is absolutely ridiculous. As, of course, as well with Fly creating those extra illusions. The illusion push is insanely real.
It's been, I think more than anything, like just some really good initiations from OG throughout this game.
S4
Centaur has, he's been hands down the MVP of this game. He's been, you look at OG and you think, who's the playmakers like to set up the kills? Do you think Jerix in the early game, S4 in the mid game, or Jerix the entire game, but not being, Jerix has been a bit quieter just because he's a leaner this game, but S4 has really been phenomenal.
So we're going to do Ramzes now with that butterfly. Put a fair bit of a punch to the fight. Pots the BKB ready to go with the Eclipse Fly. Will disrupt himself. Ramzes turns towards No-Tail. A good telekinesis. Will No-Tail be able to get a sunder off? No, he won't. S4 jumps in with a Hoostom. Not enough burst to finish off Pasha. And OG, they've got to get themselves out. VP, they're chasing a Stampede for Anna to try and get himself out of this one. Chains to hold back Ramzes. And VP, they will force them away. So they keep that top tier 3 Amrax alive. But the damage is already kind of really done over the other two lanes.
Yeah, it's mostly been done. It's like a decent-ish holding like the end to make sure they don't lose the game there. Ramzes going all in on the butterfly pickup. Many could just go in, fight with the BKB, but now BKB's down at 6 seconds, and problem's going to be this Ember. Luna is going to really struggle to fight into Ember. You start getting this permanent searing chains at level 25 when you get that extra duration. With the Octarine, it's a very, very big problem, but I like this move. VP go straight into the... I almost feel like VP want to go for like an all-in push soon like that. Oh, they just got mech creeps. Let's go five man down mid and hope we win the game, because I think VP, if they let OG reset, are in all kinds of trouble. So get an Aegis on Ramzes and just go all-in.
Yeah, they absolutely can do it. There's so much pushing potential with this Luna, and if they do find a kind of a kill off the back of the push, you know, suddenly OG are in a position where they themselves could lose a lot of their structures on the high ground.
I mean, Terrorblade, Centaur, two heroes have no buyback. Not that it's information that VP is privy to, but it is OG in a slightly vulnerable position right now. And they're definitely not going to be looking to make any moves towards that top racks during this phase unless they can find a key pick off. Maybe smoke on out, find a pick, and then make a go. But team fighting into VP is a recipe for disaster right now.
Pasha just looking to scout out at the moment the mid lane. Ramzes coming very confidently forward. And wow. In fact, they have found on the sidelines. Fly hiding on the high ground here. Actually, he is able to get himself away with that stampede. Of course, at this stage, S4 does have that axe complete. So that free pathing, allowing Fly to traverse all.
Okay.
All levels.
Not often you see a five-position support get caught out alone in the middle of nowhere and escape, but that's Centaur, I guess, and nice little push around as well. Attack. I like this from Anna, just making sure that he can punish the top lane if they go for that all-in play. Even though you're an Ember Spirit, he doesn't do physical damage, you're at least in a position to threaten with some at least minor split push. And yeah, no one's TP'd back as a result, so... VP, if you're in OG shoes, you're just thinking, okay, let's get to the timing where this Aegis expires without losing any team fights or losing any racks, and split push is a good way to kind of get there.
What do you think the next big item will be? For the Evoker, looks like he's going to queue up a Lincoln Sphere as well himself.
Okay.
You certainly see it already. It has saved, you know, Ramzes' lives as such. It does make it a lot harder for Fly to get that setup or indeed get those powerful illusions of the Luna out in the team fights.
Although I was wondering if we might get some extra lockdown, get a hex or something for the Terrorblade to make sure he doesn't get off his BKB or Sunder in these fights, but not a bad option. Defensive, but I think you're in that position where you just want to make sure you can stay alive.
There's reflection illusions here. Forcing Ramzes back. Has got the backup of Lil, Pasha, and Solo. No one now as well in the mid lane. VP with a full five man. Anna continuing to TP out, and as you mentioned earlier, just constantly putting pressure on these side lanes. So VP aren't kind of given the free pass to stay out on the map as a full five man.
Kind of knows that between at least like the Dragon Slave, the Shadow Poisons, that his teammates can click creep waves pretty well, so he's going to continue to force those TPs back to the side lanes. And this is being just slow, steady split push from Anna, just buy time, bait out the Aegis expiring. And once the Aegis expires, that's when you can kind of expect OG to make perhaps a bigger move out on the map.
Axe Now completed here for Solo. Okay.
It's one of those things, these games where it feels like Rubick hasn't done a whole lot, but you look around and there's been some alright spells to steal. I've seen her like get a really good hoof stomp in a couple of fights.
We've seen him make a few plays with the Remnants.
Yep. Yeah, the Remnants he made a really good juke at bottom lane where he got away from the Ember Spirit, but they're not spells that he's stealing that are going to win his team a fight. If he can get his hands on something like the Stampede, then yeah, ooh, he can win a fight for his team.
Kind of a fan of this as well. No one actually, he scrapped the Linker Sphere, just went for the Octarine instead.
Yeah, that's a...
I mean, it adds Octarine, he's got great levels, level 23. He is going to be able to pull off a fair bit of magic in these fights.
That's the item which will more likely carry your team the game. Lincoln, yeah. It's like you stay alive, but are you really going to win the game with the Lincolns? Going for an Octarine, even into like saying like a Refreshers, like that's the kind of build that can win your team the game, even though you are a bit squishy and more vulnerable. So VP, they hold on, but still tough. They're down those four racks, and they're not going to get anything. I mean, what they get out of the Aegis is that OG themselves don't get, because if OG got that, game could have just ended with a like five-man push down top. So it does buy them some time to farm a bit more, get a few more items. I said, I mean, Ramzes is kind of close to that 600 point. He's going to probably replace the Aegis with this queued up Skadi, so he gets more stats, more survivability. But that is more stats that can be turned against him through the reflection. But even so, we'll say, yeah, there we go. He's a couple hundred away from that Skadi, and we'll know that the Aegis expiring is going to give him the room to pick it up.
Yeah, looks like OG now ready to try and force that last set of racks, potentially, as they have the entire side on this top lane now.
Just as the Aegis expires, they're suddenly moved down the map. For the last 5 minutes, they've been near their towers, they've been on their high ground, they've been playing around like their tier 2 at top, they're maybe where their tier 2 at mid would be. They've been very defensive in nature, and you see a big shift in their position. Even the fact that Ana is with the team, it was him split pushing top, split pushing bottom. Aegis is gone, he's going to push out bottom lane for now, but he's moved out aggressively with his team, left a Remnant, and OG want to find themselves in a position to find a pick so that they can end this game. They're not looking to play to slowly win this game, they're looking for that game-winning kill that's going to really upset things.
VP themselves coming out on this top lane, and I'm going to smoke up. Ramzes won't be involved in it, so maybe trying to go for a bit of a bait with Ramzes' positioning.
Up to 3k HP now, which is nice because that Laguna Blade with the Aghanim Scepter can pierce through the BKB, so you just need all the raw HP you can get, really. And that's also where the Lincolns is pretty nice. It makes it a lot harder for that, like, disruption doesn't go, and then the stun into Laguna isn't there, or you maybe just straight up block a Laguna Blade.
It certainly feels at this stage of the game that both teams kind of afraid to bite. I mean, buyback is, you know, not available. You know, Ramzes went full in on the Skadi, and likewise, No-Tail did go full in on the Butterfly. He himself actually very close to having the buyback money back and available. And I do feel both teams, they need to be careful about these buyback situations, because we've seen how fast one another can push when there's the opening.
Yeah, OG are going to test the waters with the illusions. The illusions and maybe Ana just throwing some spells to harass a bit. And yeah, this range racks they really want can slowly be sieged. It's really tough to defend the constant illusion spam that we're seeing coming out from the SD.
Yeah, really, it's just a question of who's going to be able to catch who as they bottom poke at each other.
That reflection gets Ramzes down to almost half HP.
Oh, they do try and make a go on to Ana. Has been forced to the side. Gets the chance to Remnant out. Now Ramzes pops the BKB, ready to run in. Chasing down Fly with the Eclipse as well. OG, they'll almost certainly lose the Shadow Demon. And the rest of them will just bail out. There'll be the Tornado catching out Fly. Flies down. They do, in fact, find Lina as well with a good impale. Napasha setting up for a second kill. There we have it. They'll pick up another. Ana's come back in, but the Spike Carapace holds in position. Do they have the chain stun under control? They don't need it, because Ana, out of mana. OG losing a third hero, not getting anything from the side of VP. VP, they're holding perfectly. And yep, at this stage of the game, as we're seeing, just Invoker and Luna, incredibly beefy kind of late game cores. And seems to be a little bit too much for OG as they struggle with this final high ground push to look for the Mega Creeps.
Yeah, Invoker, one of the best level 25 late game heroes in the game. You're looking at BKBs get shorter and shorter. Luna, six slotted as well. Very, very scary. And yeah, it's an OG team who SD was very far forward, thinking that he needed to be there to save a teammate. And then once Fly has to disrupt himself to save his own life, that's when you know OG are in a terrible spot for that team fight. You never want to be seeing a Shadow Demon have to disrupt himself. That means the fight's probably a lost cause. It really was. It wasn't so much that he had to either disrupt himself or die, but it was a bad position for OG to be fighting in, and it was well played by VP to get on top of them. Nice tornado set up from the Invoker, and then they just charged forward.
There we go, and he's ready to charge into the base on the bottom lane. VP.
This is a VP that's down 5 racks, by the way. I mean, that it doesn't really feel like they lost a racks during that fight. They definitely won a team fight in a big way, and the range racks is... once you're down 4 racks, being down an extra range racks makes zero difference. Being down Mega Creeps, that's a problem.
Yeah, they do have to be careful, because as we've seen, Anna, he is the kind of guy on this Ember Spirit that is able to look for that opening up top. Obviously, still down for about 30 seconds at the moment.
And he doesn't hit the buildings enough is the thing with the Ember Spirit. Like, you can push out the lanes, but you'll see the split push coming. It's not like there's suddenly going to be... I mean, a Terrorblade in your base, that could be a big problem. Suddenly, yeah. Terrorblade's there with his illusions and Metamorphs, and suddenly, yeah, your base is going down. We'll see if Ember buys back or not. If they want to defend this Rax, he may have to.
What can they do to stop this? 20 seconds without that Ember Spirit.
Oh, what a carapace from Nyx.
There's these tornadoes and the EMPs holding back OG, allowing VP to find it. In fact, they do pick up the kill.
Nice. The glaives.
The glaives are too strong, gods.
That's a big problem. That's 40 seconds. Shadow Demon is a very important... I mean, every hero is important for OG. That's the thing. When you're playing this full core lineup, or really 5 heroes with 5, you need everyone alive to fight this 6-0 Luna.
They brought Notar down to half health. I mean, Ramzes, nice. He knows his power. He just pops the BKB. Will look to take a second set of racks. There'll be a jump in from S4. Immediately has to force himself out of that. The stolen stampede being used by VP. Now there's the turnaround. The original stampede from S4. Notar in the midst of it all, trying to man up and fight. Will be able to cut down onto the Rubick. And now moving in for more. Lil will relocate out just in time. Pasha, they have got the vision on him. S4 carrying the gem. Chasing down the Nyx Assassin. Kampasha plays his way out of it. Looks like he can. Jukes out. Will be able to escape. But again, it will be Lil, of course, left behind with the relocate back into the hands of OG. As they will end up taking down both of the supports. But of course, the damage kind of really done as VP were able to claim 2 full sets of racks.
Wonder if OG could have tried to defend before. The problem with defending against Luna is once that T3 goes down, you've lost like that lane of racks. Like, that's when the glaives start bouncing around. That's how Fly dies. The bouncing glaives onto the racks, onto the buildings, onto the huts, the shrines, and onto the Shadow Demon in the back lines. That's where you can't even... The second you try and move forward, you suddenly take like hundreds of damage.
It's a good spot.
They really need... I mean, that's the thing. They need to defend before the T3 tower. I think buying back on the Ember would have been enough to defend that T3 tower with and deter VP from pushing. It just puts yourself in a position where, oh, we just ball back on Ember. If Ember dies, we perhaps lose the game. So they didn't want to... They basically chose to lose at least one set of racks and in the end, 2 sets of racks and to not put themselves in a position where Ember had to buy back and be playing without buyback. So he's still got buyback now, but
yeah.
you're down four racks. It's a lot more even, if anything, slightly VP favored.
Have you seen this as well, guys? The double butterflies out on Ramzes this game.
I saw he had it queued up. Yeah, this is a lot of agi. I'll tell you that. Pop that flutter and I guess you got enough movement speed.
And there's no heroes that want to be building an MKB on the side of OG, so... Obviously, the evasion doesn't stack additively, but still multiplicatively, it's better than one.
Oh, we got disruption. That's some damage. Put those illusions on that Rax.
Oh, Ramzes is going to get himself back out. Notar pops the BKB, wanting to fight, going in full force here. Notar and Ramzes manning up against each other. Jarex with the Axe, looking at the blade, bringing Ramzes down like that with the Sun, and Notar keeping himself alive as he takes the life of no one, and they are going to lose the Luna. Ramzes buys back immediately. Pasha, buried up at the moment, looking to do his best to hold the high ground, will force OG back.
They're going to want to chase if they can, but...
That did cost the buyback there of Ramzes, having to invest for that defense. So OG...
That's the outcome OG were looking for. They win the fight, force a buyback, they can now regroup, prepare for Roshan if they want. They've got also, by just being up there, they get the aggressive wards down as well, so they've got good vision on that top side of the map, and Very well played team fight by them. They managed to get the disruption on the Luna as well as the Laguna Blade. Often we're seeing the Lincolns being a big problem for OG as far as getting spells off onto Luna, but if they can get spells onto Luna, it's a very different fight.
No one very close to reaching that level 25. I mean, I get, obviously in this situation as well, a lot of invokers like to get the AoE Deafening Blast, but because you're up against kind of this point where you're having to hold a push and as an Ember Spirit, do you get the reduced tornado cooldown, do you feel? Or do you still get it? It's just the AoE, just too good to miss out on.
Probably the AoE against all the Terrorblade and all these illusions. You want to be able to, you know, just hit as many people as possible, and also the disruption illusion. So yep. It was the immediate Deafening Blast. Like, once at Luna get disrupted, VP had to fight and commit because those Luna illusions would instantly destroy the racks. They actually use spells on the Luna illusions more than they were using them on the OG heroes, just because those two Luna illusions with the double butterflies would have torn up the VP base.
Ramses into the pit. Can OG do anything about this? If they win this Roche fight, it almost certainly could be the game. Anna and Notail ready to go in. Pretty hard to do so on the side. No one yules up. Anna jumps in, but immediately no one pots the BKB. Turns towards Fly. Forces back. Anna jumps into the midst of it all. Bringing them down. Lil falling down, and they'll take the IO. They'll get the kill to the Evoker as well. Pasha buried up, but is it going to be enough to keep him alive? It looks like he is. They can't quite finish him off. Finally goes down to a side of Fizz. There'll be a buyback for no one, but look at the damage that Ramses is dishing out. The dual butterflies are too strong by the looks of it. Two buybacks from OG as they come back into it. Roshan will remain alive.
Oh, Notail did not save for buyback. He bought the javelins, didn't sell his ring. He doesn't have buyback. If he had buyback, he could buy back and secure Roshan, possibly win the game.
It looks like
here.
They may get it anyway, though.
Yeah, they will get this anyways. I mean, VP, you're really scared now. You have no buyback on Luna or Invoker. This game is really at a kind of all-in-ish stage. And getting an Aegis on the Ember Spirit who just bought back, very, very useful for OG. So they will still get it anyways. Terrorblade now has the money for buyback. He won't have to use it. And now they can push forward. They can perhaps farm a bit more on Terrorblade to make sure he has buyback once again. And then go for that last racks with Aegis, with Cheese. And try and find that key pickoff on one of these core heroes to take them out of the game for a long, long time.
VP throwing a lot into that last fight.
Yeah.
Overall, we're seeing gold swing. It's up and down, up and
so
down.
So even still. I mean, Fly's doing a really good job of getting on top of the Luna, finding a timing to get the disruption illusion. And the second Luna's disrupted, VP are like, all right, we're going to fight. We're going to throw some stuns at those illusions, stun the rest of OG. OG's trying to go in off of that disruption.
Anna's got to be careful. Ooh, Pasha. Nearly catching Anna out there.
Not the time to be getting too greedy as an Ember. You've got your items.
They've got to be ever so careful at this stage of the game.
Hex on the Invoker. That's the other big item that Anna has to be wary of. And that extra lockdown and initiation.
Does have the Lincoln. Has the BKB in the stash as well, yeah, that you can bring out.
Perhaps more for Notail. Like if you go on him, he's not got the Lincolns, and you can get him before a BKB or after a BKB and stop a Sunder from happening. So definitely useful to have here. But we'll see how VP handle this situation. They're going to be feeling a lot better now that they've taken those two lanes of racks themselves. Before that, it was a 5 racks advantage. And right now, the big problem is really like OG. You've got the vision everywhere. You've got the Aegis and Cheese. You've got the buyback advantage. Both Luna and Invoker without buyback. Meanwhile, Terrorblade actually going to go for the MKB. Doesn't that opt to stay? I guess you've got no travel, so if you buy back and you're going for a push, you can't immediately get back in the fight. But having the MKB against this double butterfly now going to make a big difference as far as DPSing through the BKB. When Luna BKBs on the front lines with double butterfly, she won't be immortal. She'll have TP Illusions with MKB, as well as a potential Laguna Blade coming directly at her face.
And OG, realizing this position is strength, poised on the top lane, ready to go. Is that Notail on his floor? It looks like they're kind of backing off, you know, they're thinking about it. Fly and Jarrett still staying very much close to the lane. You have Anna continually just forcing in in that bottom lane. So all lanes are being pressured onto the side of the map of VPs, up to the high ground.
Noctel gets this MKB out of his backpack before a fight happens. Maybe just looking, I mean, he's got a TP there, but you don't need to be keeping your, you can keep your TP in the stat. There we go. Let's say if he fights with that in his backpack, oh god, he'll be kicking himself after this game.
Yeah, he's got the cheese as well being handed over.
That's handy. He's still only got 1800 HP. That feels very lackluster when you compare it to like the Luna, who's sitting on 3.4k. Luna going to get chipped away at.
Yeah, we'll see how much of a difference that MKB makes if Noctel can get his hands on Ramzes.
Kuru going out. Looks like Luna is going for an MKB.
Yeah, I get it. She kind of needs it because of herself, really, doesn't she? So she can deal with her own illusions that are being sent at her.
Well, kind of works. Yeah, yes and no, maybe? I guess she's also giving the MKB to the opposing team's illusions
That's
to
true.
Hit her. But
it works both ways.
Yeah. But yeah, now she'll be able to at least kill the Terrorblade a little bit easier. Kind of maybe toggle between these a little bit, but... The Lunar illusions from the Shadow Demon are being dealt with very well. Like, Viper actually prioritizing disabling them, bursting them down. Anytime Luna's been disrupted, there's been like a big concerted effort from the Nyx especially to go in, Carapace, impale them, throw as many spells as possible onto them. But yeah, this game's getting tense now. Buybacks, 50 seconds. So
50
this,
seconds on
this window for the Luna, and the Invoker is probably similar.
Oh
no, Invoker's 250 actually. So Luna's buyback was from some time ago. The Invoker's was the more recent one in the fight around Roche. That's where Luna will be probably just saying, like, guys, just hopefully we can defend out one more wave, and if I have to die for another high ground hold, that's an acceptable trade.
Interesting though as well, it looks like, Ramzes did sell, he sold his second butterfly to buy the MKB.
Yeah. He's seen the MKB on Terrorblade, so that double butterfly lost a lot of its value. Still okay to have one, you're using the flutter to move around a bit. It's great agi and all that, but you're kind of looking at more raw damage at this point. The stacking no longer quite as useful. And we've actually smoked up here. I'm not sure how well this can work. Nice ward from Jerix on the high ground, and this could potentially set them up for something.
I've got the Atos into the Soul Catcher combination onto the Luna, jumping from S4, but immediate tornado, no one's there with the combo. S4 hexed up. Ramzes puts the BKB ready to go with the Eclipse as well. Anna still going to jump forward, looking for Pasha with the Sleight of Fist, bringing him down low. Anna getting nuked down out of the mana though with his mana, but it immediately ripped to pieces. The Aegis on the floor. Lil, can he keep himself alive here? Noctel pounding into him, will take down Io already. VPR having to back away. Anna turns towards Pasha. Pasha forced back with the Vendetta starting to back off. There'll be a buyback from Solo. They have kept the melee Rex alive for the time being, but immediately Solo stunned up. There'll be a jump in, but immediately S4 again with the reaction play. Hitting the two-man Houston, opening the final set of Rex to be taken down as OG have now claimed Mega Creeps. And with three heroes down on VP, no buyback left on them, there's very little they could do. Ramzes is going to send himself forward, tries to mantle off the Light Strike Array, but it's not going to happen. Ramzes is down. OG have done it here in game one and finally take the victory. I mean, boy oh boy, did VP make them fight for it. OG proving to be the stronger side at the end of the day in this first game. Some very flashy performances, but once again, you've really got to talk about S4. He showed us one of the best performances on center, I feel like we've seen in a long time.
That was, he controlled that early mid-game so impressively. That fight at bottom where he hit the three heroes, that was where VPs seemed to be finding their groove, starting to make some aggressive moves, and suddenly he turns around some VP invasion into their jungle with a three-man stomp into the... That was the Ember's recovery. Up until that point, Anna was getting grabbed on.
And Anna did recover. You've got to give kudos to him, how he kind of climbed his way back up after those three very damaging kind of pickoffs that were done from Pasha's rotations at the start in the mid lane. Ends of the game, 14-5-18. Anna just showing that he's definitely a player that can recover from a start that was pretty horrible.
Yeah, I mean, OG really prioritizing, making sure everyone got farm, got key items. It was the fact that Luna had to be worried about a Laguna Blade, had to be worried about Disruption, had to be worried about the Ember, the Centaur, the Terrorblade. Every single hero posed a threat, whereas on VP's side, the Eye of the Rubick, they're playing this very true defensive support nature, sit behind, wait for a counterplay. Like, Lil's involvement was pretty much just sitting behind Luna, tethering and overcharging to help keep her alive in the fights as much as possible. We weren't really seeing any aggressive plays using the relocate. VP were just on the back foot for too much of this game.
Oh, definitely as close of a matchup as we expected from games in this series between these two sides, OG versus Virtus Pro. OG to take game one. Don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back very, very shortly with game two in this final series of the day.